properly.
Okay.
So can you hear me now, Belle?
I don't hear you, but I think they do.
Let me check here. So if I'm talking, can you hear me? I'm trying to see if I can hear myself on my iPad. I'm not being silly here. No, I don't think I can. Check, check, sound check. If anybody is out there already on Facebook, please say yes if you can hear me.
You see yourself live on Facebook?
I do see myself live on Facebook, but I don't hear anything. I've got the volume turned up for a second. There we go.
I do see myself live on Facebook, but I don't hear any.
It's live sound now. It is working. Hi, Julia. You can hear me. Thank you.
We have sound problems every time we log on.
Yeah, it always takes us a minute because it's hard to tell at our end if the sound is working or not. Sometimes it appears not to be when it is and vice versa. So I've got this set up now too so that I can see the comments, Bill. We'll get started in a second here. We are started because we are here, but set that up so I can hopefully see your questions as they come in today. Saw Julia on the Huzzah this morning with Sandra Van Sickle. Can you hear it now, Bill?
Yeah, it wasn't coming up on my phone for some reason.
Yeah, it took a minute to get on mine too, so. Could be the internet too, who knows. But so as you come in, so good afternoon. I am Kim Shagnon from Kim's Upholstery, located here in Greenfield, Massachusetts. And we do these live events on Facebook every Wednesday at 12:30. And the reason we do these live is just so you can see the real world of an upholstery workroom and what happens there at the time happens, you know, it's real live time. So it happens as it does, and it's not, you know, any performance or whatever, it's what's actually going on. So we do these, like I said, every Wednesday at 12:30. And we are in our new workspace, which I know you get to see a virtual tour of our new workspace about a month ago now. Actually, has it been? We've been here about a month and a half, almost 2 months. And we're loving the new space. But today I'm actually not going to be working on upholstery. I am working on window treatments, which is a very small portion of my business here in Greenfield. So as you come in onto the feed on Facebook, just type hi so that we know you're there. And we'll say hello to you. Hello, Sandra and Julia. I know you are both here. If you also, as you come in, tell us where you're from, because it's fun to see the different people from around the world and around the country that join us here live on Facebook. And if you're in the soft home furnishings industry, go ahead and tell us what you're working on in your workroom. And if you're not, tell us a little bit about yourself and what you are doing. I know a lot of people join us on their lunch break. You know, some of the members of our online classes are not in the business as of yet, and they're doing something else for a job, and they'll join us on our lunch break. So if that's the case, go ahead and tell us that too, because we just love to know who's out there and what you're doing today and where you're from. Hi, Josie. I see Josie has joined us. Let's see. Julia wants to have a question about her cushion that she's doing. Do I need to add an extra half inch to the foam? The foam is going into a down insert from Harris Pillows. Do I need to add an extra half inch to the foam? I think I need a little bit more information, Julia. I know that you are doing, I know the project you're referring to, it's that striped chair, that you're doing a slip cover and you're taking and adding a cushion to a situation that's currently a tight seat because the client wants it a little higher and a different comfort. So I do know that portion. So let me give you an example here. So let's say that you're doing a 4-inch finished boxing and you're doing a down envelope like you're doing. I typically would use like a 3-inch foam inside that for an average amount of down, but it really, you know, there's a lot of variables here. So if your client has asked you for more down and you've got a lot more down in your envelope than I'm envisioning, you might even need a 2-inch foam. So I don't know what you mean by the extra half inch. So the foam is generally, like I said, there's so many variables. You can do this so many different ways. I typically have my foam an inch smaller than my finished boxing when I'm doing that situation, because I really want that comfort and plumpness of the down or the down Dacron combo that they have sometimes. So again, it really depends. So if you have any more specifics that you want to throw in there, if I didn't quite answer your question, go ahead and throw those in. I see that Carol Sear has joined us. Hello, Carol. I'm just making sure I haven't missed anybody else. I think I seem to have gotten everybody. So Julia, if that didn't answer your question, oh, here we go. Julia's responding. So do I need to cut the foam the same as the seat measurements? Aha, so you're talking your width and depth, I get by that question. Typically it is smaller. Sometimes a half inch is enough and sometimes it's not. Sometimes it even needs to be more small. Smaller than a half inch, but typically I would I guess my answer would be start with a half inch and you can always take it down. I have a chair that I did for myself that was a situation similar to what you're doing, and I had it was a down poly combo, I think, that I used for the wrap instead of a full down. And I had the company do the whole thing for me. So they put the foam in and they made the foam the size of the finished cover. And what I didn't like about that is over time, as you sat on that cushion, it actually caused the boxing to push out almost like a bullnose cushion would be. And so I ended up taking the foam out. And I think on mine, I cut like an inch and a half off the depth to get what I wanted. So I would start small, start by trimming a half inch, and put it in, see if you like the way it looks. You know, sit on it before you give it to the client and see what the foam does, because you could always take more off, but you don't want to start off too heavy and take too much off and then need to put it back on. So I would start small, start with a half inch. So I think I've got your question. As far as the width, it's the same kind of thing. The width is more closer to the finished width than the front and back depth. The front and back depth is really what can make that cushion look not so good. So Charles Turner's is here. Hi, Charles. I see you're joining us live today. We haven't seen you in a while. Hope everything's going well at your end. If anybody has any questions while we're here, just go ahead and shoot them at me. When the cameraman has a second, I'm going to have him scan over and show you the cushions that I had worked on prior to our vacation. So we have some people on YouTube, Bill's telling me. So hello to you out there on YouTube. And go ahead on YouTube and also post in your questions and where you're from, because Bill can feed those questions to me. I can't see them on my iPad here because I can only watch one place at a time.
Sorry, but I don't speak Vietnamese either.
And Bill says we have somebody from Vietnamese and he apologizes because we don't speak your language. But hello, and we're glad you joined us.
Vietnam.
Hi, Karen. You're in Kansas City working on slip covers. Ah, fun. My next project actually next week is a slip cover that I'm going to be doing for somebody. I love slip covers. Slip covers and upholstery are my favorite. Window treatments are not my favorite to do. But that is what I'm doing today. So if you are ready, Bill, if you want to scan over here, we can show you guys last week before we, or actually a week and a half ago, 2 weeks ago now, before we left for vacation, I was working on these cushions live on camera. So here you can see the client hasn't picked them up yet, all the different fabrics I was working with. So I've got this strié that is the seat cushion for one of their glider rockers, and then I've got the dining room chair cushions, which are behind there and also in that strié. And we've used, I'll move this one out of the way. There's a little sofa that goes with this set, and that is this solid gray fabric. So the client was really adventurous. She's very much a very monochromatic grays, black is in her whole house. So to convince her to throw in this little pop of pattern here was quite a task. But once she saw the fabric, she did fall in love. So she was hooked. So we did this funky little pattern here to throw in the mix. And it's got this tan in here, which she really liked, even though she's a gray, beige, black girl. She really liked that tan. So we threw that in there. And then we added this striped pillow just to give it a little more wow. So this is out of her typical comfort zone. But I know when she sees it all done, she's going to love it. Like I said, she just hasn't picked this up yet. She'll be here the end of this week to pick up this project. And here's another little fun project that I was able to do, just making sure I'm holding it in the right place for you. This was a needlepoint. For those of you that are familiar with needlepoint, you know how much work goes into that. So the client had done this small needlepoint project, and she was trying to decide what to do with it to use it in her home. She really didn't want it framed on the wall in a picture frame or anything. So we chatted a bit, and we came up with making her this small pillow, which will go in her home. And I convinced her to go with one of the orange fabrics. Oops, trying to get it in the right spot for you guys to look. So I convinced her to go into one of these orange colors for her accent. So as I turn the pillow around here, you can see we've used an orange chenille and we've used an orange belt cord from the same fabric. Because her room is predominantly the beiges and she has a little bit of blue accent. But to make this pillow stand out in the crowd, so to speak, she was really agreeable with the idea of to bring that orange pop into her room to, because, you know, she put a lot of work into this, so why not make it special? So if you have clients that do needlepoint and different things like that, it's always a good idea that you can do something like this. I opted not to put a zipper in this and to hand sew it shut just because I couldn't trim down. I mean, those of you who are familiar with needlepoint know what the base looks like, and I didn't want to trim that down and have it have any chance of letting go at any point in time. So I left it's about an inch and a half border, I think, that was on the needlepoint frame. So that's inside this pillow, and with the padding or with the Dacron in here, you really don't even know what's in there. So it didn't cause any excess bulk. But I didn't want to put a zipper in it because I was afraid it would damage that with the opening and closing of the zipper. So I opted to not do that for that particular project. So let me look and see. So have any of you ever done any needlepoint projects like that for your clients? It's always a fun little add-on when you can do something like that for somebody. Julia says fun fabrics. Hello Peg, I see you have joined us. Sophia, you're here. Hello Sophia. And Jessica Eyre is here. So hello everyone. Glad you're taking the time out of your busy schedules to join us. Let me know what you're working on here in the feed as we're chatting in my workroom today. I did mention for those of you coming in later that I am working on drapes today. They're actually cafe curtains for a kitchen area. So I'm not doing any upholstery this morning. I'm just going to try to sit this so I can still see your feed and go ahead and start cutting my fabric. Sophia is from Greece. Hey, Sophia. I love the pictures I see of Greece. Someday I would love to get over there and see all the beauty that you guys have. And hello, Diana Hershey. I see you've joined us. I'm actually going to be seeing Diana in just a short time because she signed up for one of our workshops. So I will be seeing Diana in Williamsburg, Virginia. Actually, it's outside of Williamsburg, Virginia. On the 10th of September, so not too far away. So let me just make sure I'm not missing any questions. Do we have any questions on YouTube, maybe?
We have a person who identifies him or herself as Witchbag from India.
Hello, Witchbag from India. Nice to see you out there on YouTube. So Sophia, you'll have to share some pictures from Greece with us on our page. I love seeing a friend of mine recently, I think it was like last fall, she went to Greece and she showed some gorgeous pictures of just the architecture and the way, you know, the way your buildings are along the ocean, I'm assuming. It was just really pretty. What are you doing?
Just wanted you to move over so we have those pillows in the background.
Okay, just checking to see if anything. Okay, so Julia Tama is asking me if the slipcover class is full. No, Julia, it is not. We still actually have 4 spots in that slipcover class. So for those of you that aren't familiar with the slipcover class that I've got coming up, now that we're in our new location here in Greenfield, we are doing local workshops. So we have an upholstery workshop that filled up almost immediately. That was at the beginning of October. And we have a 2-day slipcover workshop, which is November 5th and 6th. So it's a Saturday and Sunday, an all day, both days it'll be all day long. We'll get lunch brought in and everything, and you work on your own chair. So people come with their own piece of furniture, make their slipcover, and you get to go home with a completed project for your house. So that is in, like I said, November, November 5th and 6th. So those are the first 2 workshops we've launched in our new location, and we're working on an Ottoman workshop. We're still going through the deciding factors of having like kits available for people or whether we want to let people bring in their own ottomans. And we're leaning towards the kits because we think it would be fun. Everybody gets a brand new project. So we're working on dates for that. But the slipcover still has room. And then the Williamsburg, Virginia class that Diana is joining me for has 1 space left still in that class. But you don't have much time to get into that because you need to tear down your chair prior to class, so it doesn't leave you much time if you join up now. Whoops, I lost my list of questions here. Let me just get this back where it needs to be. Doesn't look like there's any, oh wait a minute. Jessica says, I'm working on shades today and getting ready to install cornices tonight. Installing at night, you're a brave woman. I like to do my installations first thing in the morning when I'm fresh, because at the end of the day, my brain's a little fried, so having to do the math when the client's in the background talking to you sometimes is not great. So I tend to do my installations in the morning, so good for you.
Sophia's here from Greece.
I already did that one, Bill. Looks like I have got everybody that's here. For some reason, it's not refreshing at my end, so you may need to start feeding me who comes in.
Yeah, it's...
Because it's... The internet, you all know how the internet and technology is. Internet works great when it wants to, and when it decides it's going to take a nap, it certainly does. So if I do miss your questions or comments, you know, we do try to go back through the feed later on in the day, and I try to answer anybody that I didn't get to answer during the live conversation. But also, for those of you who are joining us for the first time, you'll see on, I think it's actually on the image where you see me talking, there is a spot there where you can, I think it says subscribe. So if you check on that, then you'll be notified every time we go live. You'll get a little pop-up message from Facebook that says, hey, Kim's live over there on Kim's Upholstery. And then you can join us so you don't miss out on any of our live events. We're hoping to do more of them later. We're also still looking for some sort of a platform to replace the blabs, because we really did enjoy the blabs with our online members and being able to answer their questions. So we are hoping that something else is in the works, which we think it is. Is it YouTube, Bill, that's working on something for that? To do the like what we did for Blab, where we could have multiple people.
Well, everybody and their brother is. So.
Yeah, so there's some platforms out there working on that. So we're hoping to get to do that sometime in this fall.
I'm hoping to do Hangouts on Air through YouTube.
So I don't know if you can hear Bill, but he's hoping that we can make it work with Hangouts on Air through YouTube. And that the benefit of that is you can actually come in live with me on camera from your own space and ask the questions face to face. And some of the platforms when we did Blab, you could actually send us pictures and we could post the pictures and talk about a specific project that you're working on. And we miss being able to do that with our followers and with the members of our online classes. So we're hoping to get back to doing that soon.
Sophia's asking if you work on real antique pieces.
Yes, we do. We do work on some real antique pieces. So Sophia's asking if we work on antique pieces. Sorry, repeating her question for those of you who might not have seen it in the feed. And yes, we do. In fact, I've got a client that emailed me some pictures today. And these pieces have not been reupholstered for 70 some odd years. So they were, one was her grandmother's and a couple were her parents. And then she has one that was her husband's parents. And she emailed me those images today, so we're going to be giving her an estimate. So we do antique projects, and a lot of times they have great sentimental value. And it's hard because some people don't understand the cost. You know, the cost of labor for upholstery is not inexpensive. And so the antique pieces are more worth doing than some of the modern pieces that haven't been on the market too long. So it's really nice when people save these old pieces. In fact, most of the furniture in our house, which my husband will tell you I'm a little bit of a hoarder when it comes to antique furniture side the road. Side the road, dumpster diving, flea markets. I've actually made Bill go in a dumpster for a chair before, which he looked at me and was like, really? You owe me big time for this one. But most of the furniture in our house is roadside treasures or flea market finds that are antique good bone structures that we've done. They don't look like rustic anymore. They look nice now, but you don't
Aisha,
see any other.
Aisha is here.
Hi, Aisha.
That's on YouTube.
Aisha's watching us from YouTube. You're probably on lunch break, Aisha. Julia says that is true love for Bill diving in the dumpster, I presume. Yeah, I really thought he was going to shoot me on that one. Doesn't own a gun, but you know what I mean. But you just, hey, you got to go where the treasures are, right? You see them and you got to get them. Another good time is in our area. We have, what, four or five colleges in the area, Bill? Five? I don't know, I can't think of them all on top of my head, but we have several colleges in the area anyway, and a lot of times the students will go to like Goodwill and those places to buy furniture for their, you know, their dorm rooms or their apartments, and then when they leave for the season, they just stick them side the road because they don't want to take them home, and so you can find a lot of free stuff side the road during those phases of college, you know, moving in and out. So there's a lot of stuff around here that you can find. And we have an auction house, which is literally like 15 minutes down the road from where we live, and they have an auction every Friday, and you can get some really great pieces for under $50. I am one of these people that set myself a budget when I'm doing something like that, and I usually don't pay more than $20 for a piece of furniture that I'm gonna reupholster for myself, and you can get some really good frames. We've had some really good wingback chairs over the years that we've actually purchased the frame at auction and then put them in our showroom and put a price tag on them for the cost of reupholstering labor and, you know, estimate on fabric, and people will buy those old frames and put, you know, pick the fabric that they have put on it. We found that works much better than trying to do a piece and put it in the showroom for sale, because you never pick the right fabric for somebody's home. So that way it's exactly what they want, and they know up front what the labor costs are going to be, and they're getting a good structure frame that's, you know, an older piece that's hardwood and eight-way ties. So that has worked really well for us in the past.
Okay, so which bag says she wishes she lives closer to you so she could take lessons, you inspire her and...
Oh, well, thank you, Witchbag. Where are you from, actually? Where are you located?
She is in Greece, I believe. India.
India. Okay, that's right. He did tell me India. I just, short memory term here sometimes. Yeah, I wish, you know, I'm willing to travel, too. I've got some people from the UK that would love to have a class. So I've got a friend poking around for me who has relatives out there to see if we can find a location to do that. But yeah, I would love to travel to India and do that for you. If you ever come here, you know how to find us. So Sophia says she has an old FAF sewing machine. So Sophia, is that an industrial FAF or a domestic? I'm assuming you must mean industrial, but I don't know. Let's see, Charles says, and I like the fabric re-roll that I see. Please do a video on how to build this. So Charles, I think Bill has something on YouTube, don't you, Bill, on this re-roll system? Not building it? So building it, I mean, the main part to build is to figure out how to anchor it to your table. The rest of it is just pretty simple construction. It's just really triangles, well, more like a trapezoid. And then it's the bracket that hooks to your table. So your table design might be a lot different than ours, but we can put some close-up pictures out there so you can see how we've made it work for us. But it really does work great. You know, it pulls the fabric underneath the second roll, which makes it come out nice and smooth and taut. Yeah, right now I'm using it to pull my fabric out to make my cuts. I wasn't using it in the re-roll situation right now, so yeah. Let's see, Sandra says her youngest daughter has caught the upholstery fever. She sent her a photo of a wingback chair she found on the side of the road this morning. Awesome. Yeah, it is definitely an addiction, I have to say. You know, most of you have probably heard my story, or if you didn't, maybe you listened to the podcast and heard my story there too. That I didn't intend to start an upholstery business. It was one of those things that I had a piece of furniture to do for ourselves, and the rest is history, and it just kind of snowballed. And once you do that first piece, you do find yourself hunting down the road and, you know, like slamming on the brakes to get a piece of furniture that you see side the road. One day I was taking my daughter and a friend, and this was the first time her friend had ever come to our house, and they wanted to go to the movies. So I said, sure, I'll take you guys to the movies. And it was a rainy day, and we're driving down the road, and we were a little early. I knew we had plenty of time, and all of a sudden I pull side the road, and she covers her face, and she's like, Mom, you're not going back to get that chair, are you? And I'm like, yeah, you and Serena can help me load it. She's like, no, don't do this to me. This is embarrassing. And so I turned the van around, opened the back door of the van, and I had her and her friend Serena help me load the chair and the ottoman in the back of the van. And I think my daughter like moaned about that for months, probably, how embarrassed she was that her mother was picking up this trash side the road. But we had that chair in our living room for a long time. Before we were tired of it, we put it side the road. But it was a really great structure bone. So once you start doing it, you do get addicted. It is, and it's a good addiction. I like it. And you get to use lots of fabrics, which I'm also addicted to. Hello, Crystal. I see you're joining us. I saw you put another picture of a chair on Instagram. I think I saw it yesterday. It looked really nice. Crystal does a lot of upholstery projects. Just looking here, I don't see any other questions. I don't see if Sophia responded to the FAF being industrial, so if I missed it, I'm sorry. But I have already gotten the squared off the end of my fabric here, so I'm gonna go ahead and make that cut. I'm making, like I said, these are a bunch of cafe curtains, and this fabric has teacups on it, which is kind of cute, so it's going in this woman's kitchen. Step out of the camera a second while I put my square back. So it's going in the woman's kitchen, so I have to pay attention to that the teacups all land in the right row as I'm making these panels as well. Bill says we may have a sound issue here.
Check your
so bear with us. I didn't do anything that I know of. Can you guys still hear me?
Yeah, it's me.
It's Bill. Okay, Bill lost his sound. We're good. You never know where the problem is either. So, because he's trying to run the cameras and he's also trying to listen on his cell phone. He's got it plugged into a headset so he can listen on the cell phone so he knows what's happening. And we've been having, Bill's got this, got an iPhone, and for some reason lately it has been, he keeps it in his shirt pocket and it has been dialing people and FaceTiming people without him realizing. All of a sudden he'll hear somebody talking to him and he's like, where's that coming from? And it's somebody in his pocket going, Bill, you FaceTimed me again. And we have no idea why his phone keeps doing that. But I have to say, the people he's FaceTiming are all women, so I'm wondering if I should worry. So I'm just cutting my fabric square here. I've picked a part that I think is going to work out fine for my pattern placement. But this is actually a cute little fabric. It's a damask, so it's got the, now the word's totally escaping me here. It's got the print in the background that's the tone on tone, and then it's got the teacups on top of it. It's kind of an interesting, I like the teacups, but I'm not so sure I like the damask in the background because it's not always in the same place in the pattern, which I thought was kind of funky. You know, sometimes it's in the middle of the teacup and sometimes it's in the middle of the cross pattern from the ribbon. So it's kind of different. So what's my favorite industrial sewing machine, Sophia is asking. I am a Juki girl, and my very first sewing machine was a Singer, which was absolutely fine. It was an old machine which didn't have the walking foot mechanism. And then after that, I bought my first Juki and I was hooked. I just love the Jukis. They hold up well. They've got a lot of different variations for feet that you can get for both the walking foot and the non-walking foot machine. So Juki, I have to say, is my favorite. I do have a Conso, which is a zigzag straight stitch tacker combination machine, and it's perfectly fine. There's nothing wrong with it. But I do tend to favor my Jukis.
How many years have you been doing draperies?
Let's see, I've been doing draperies since 2005-ish, so 10-11 years I've been doing draperies. Started the business with strictly upholstery, hence the name Kim's Upholstery. I wasn't very inventive, I guess. It was like, that makes sense, let's go with it. And then I got my first client that asked me to do drapes, probably right around 2005, 2006. I had never ever done a pair of pinch pleat drapes before. I had done, my mother had made curtains for like my house when I first had a home, and she helped me with stuff. We did tab tops and things like that, but we always did it together. And then I got asked to do this pinch pleat drape job, and unfortunately my mother had passed away, so I didn't have anybody to say help. But being the type of personality I am, I'm like, of course I can do that. Somebody else figured it out. I can figure it out, right? So they were, I think they were like 100 and something, like 106 inches or so long, and it was like 5 widths wide. So it was 2 panels that were 2.5 widths. Pure white pinch pleat drapes. Never done these before. We're working in the garage in our old space. The very first space we had was a big, huge garage that we had, working on the table with these drapes. And I had one of these chalk markers that I used that was yellow, not knowing that yellow doesn't come off the fabric. You know, you figure your chalk, it's going to come out. So I'm marking my little spots with yellow, and this chalk's not going away. So that was my first panic attack with drapes. And then as we're working, all of a sudden these bugs started coming in. It was, you know, early evening and landing on the fabric. And of course, you know, if you go to swipe a bug off, they usually smush. And I'm like, oh no, white drapes, smushed bugs, yellow chalk. I was just like, panic attack. So we just kind of shut the lights off, went in the house, and came back out in the morning and regrouped. I swore after that project I would never do another set of window treatments in my life, and here I am. still doing them.
Sophia wants to know how to spell Juki. J U K I E. You leave out the E.
Yeah, no E on the end, Sophia. It's J U K I is Juki. Hi, Lorinda. And I see Aisha has moved over to Facebook, and Gwen is here. Hello, Gwen. So the sound is going in and out at your end, Gwen. Anybody else having that issue? But the sound, sometimes it's the speed of the internet when you're doing these live things. You just never know. Check my mic too, because I could have. Yeah, sometimes I bump mine too, so it gets staticky. So Lorinda, you told her how to spell Juki. Do you have a Juki, Lorinda? What other, so for those of you watching, type in what type of sewing machine you have, because like I said, I just happen to favor the Jukis. So Lorinda is from Oklahoma.
Sounds good there.
Sounds great at your end. Good, thanks. So yeah, so type in what brand machines you use. Like I said, I started with a Singer. Growing up as a kid, my mother always had Singer domestic machines. And I think my very first sewing machine as a kid was a Brother. It was my grandmother's hand-me-down. And like I said, all the machines I've used, I've never had any complaints with any of them, except for that Singer. It was just so old that keeping a straight stitch and everything, or keeping a consistent tension, rather than not straight stitch, was always a problem. What was that, Bill?
Well, I was just saying what a deal that was from Harbor Freight with the pin dish. We didn't realize it was...
What was it, like $2.99?
Yeah.
Want to throw one of those at me?
I'd love to.
Hey, wait a minute. He just said he would literally throw one at me. I wanted to show you guys the great deal we got. I don't know if you have a Harbor Freight near you, or if you use these for your pins. Of course, the one I want is not near me. So everybody is probably familiar with the magnetic pin dishes. So we recently were getting ready to set up for the upholstery workshop that we're having here. So Bill was needing some stuff for hose hookups. I'm just looking to see who's typed in here. We've got Lorinda has a Juki straight stitch. She sold her Conso walking foot, and that was a big mistake. She says, yeah, getting rid of your walking foot. Those things, those babies are good for what they're good for. Aisha has a baby lock. She's a baby lock girl. Sandra has a Yamada, a Juki, a Conso, and a Singer. And I always know, she who dies with the most sewing machines wins. I think I've got 10. So Yamada, Sandra. I have never heard of a Yamada. So back to my pin dish. So we went to Harbor Freight to get hookups for the hoses for our upholstery workshop, and we found these magnetic pin dishes, which I'm sure you've seen through sewing stores, $2.99 a piece at Harbor Freight. And I think I don't remember which company it was online I was looking at. There's several of them. I think they were like $6 or $7 a piece. So $2.99, and they are the smaller ones. Because you do have the large size too, but I love the small ones for when I'm working on a slip cover. They're perfect. But yeah, $2.99. I thought that was like such a deal. So we bought enough for every student in our slip cover class to have their own little pin dish during class to work on their slip cover. Great deal, Harbor Freight. So check it out. So let's see who else is talking about their sewing machines. Hi, Pat. Pat says, can you make slip covers using duck cloth or some similar weight fabric using a domestic machine? She has a Brother Novus, which I'm not familiar with that machine, Pat. What I would suggest is going to the fabric store and getting a quarter of a yard of fabric that's a similar consistency or weight to the fabric you're considering using, or the same fabric if you can, and see how many layers you can get through your sewing machine. When you're doing a slip cover, there are sections, I think, if I remember correctly, there are sections where I'm going through like 8 or 9 layers of fabric at a time making a slip cover, and that's where you've got like your cording and your intersections of seams. So you've got like 2 layers of cording fabric crossing plus your fabrics. So you want to make sure that you can get it through your machine. So I would test that. I had actually a woman from our online classes call earlier today, and she's getting ready to do some cushions, and it's really hard to know whether your machine can handle it without you just testing it. Some of the instruction books, if you're looking at purchasing a machine, look and see what they're rated for. If they're rated for heavy duty use, and they will specifically say upholstery fabrics on there and things, And anyone that's rated for upholstery fabric would be able to handle a slip cover, but the domestics, it's iffy sometimes. Okay, so Jessica.
Switchbag's going back to work.
Thanks for joining us, Switchbag, and have a good rest of your day at work. I wonder what time it is where you are.
I wonder what her real name is, not Witchbag.
Yeah, I'm assuming you're, I don't know if we're saying Witchbag the right way or not, but if you've got another real name, let us know. So enjoy the rest of your day back to work. Let's see, so Jessica has a walking foot, or Juki walking foot, a baby lock, and a console blind hemmer. Aisha says, I have an Alpha Sewing walking foot machine. It's another brand I've never heard of. And she can't remember her blind hemmer brand. Sandra loves the pin bowls. Lorinda bought the SailRite machine after watching our video. Yeah, that's a great little machine. I have one. You can't see it from where I am now, but I do have the LS1 for the SailRite machine, and it is a nice, heavy-duty little machine.
They just came out with a double cording foot.
That's right, yeah. SailRite came out with, and I have actually tried it, and we should do a video on that for you guys to see. SailRite just came out with a double welt foot for their sewing machines, and it works really great. It's a good little foot. Pat says, thanks, great idea for testing out fabric. Yeah, it's the only way you're really going to tell before you commit to all that yardage. I think I've caught up on the questions here. If I'm missing them, sorry. Let's see. So, Lorinda, have you used the SailRite for much yet? I mean, I used it actually. I don't know where I'm going here. I used it for an outdoor cushion job that I was doing that my walking foot was even struggling with the Sunbrella fabric, and the SailRite machine was like a breeze. It didn't pucker it at all. It went right through. So it worked really good. I don't see any questions. No more machines listed. I think we got them all. Seems to be a lot of Jukis out there. And my domestic machine that I have is a Brother. This is a horrible story. I had a Viking, I think it was. I don't even remember how old it was, but it was a domestic home machine. And one day I went to pick it up in its carry case. And you probably know the story. I'm watching, trying to figure out what Bill was trying to do. So I go and I pick up the carry case, and you know how it's got those little brackets that like flip to lock the bottom to it? Well, evidently I didn't put them in place right. I picked it up and the whole thing smashed to the ground. So it no longer works. So that's why I bought myself a Brother. Lorinda hasn't had a chance to do much with hers yet. But it's so dang cute. I know, isn't it? It's nice that it comes in a nice color too. They got blue ones and red ones. They're different models, I think, the different colors. But where is my sheet with my cutting things? I should be working while I'm talking too, huh? So I made myself my little notes. Usually I have a sheet that I fill in, but since we moved, I have not found the sheet, so I've got to print some more out from the computer, which I just keep forgetting to do. Were you going to go over and look at the...
Well, I was just going to kind of spin around and show you a layout here.
So you can see when Bill moves the camera, except for I've got those cushions piled on one machine. So this is my blind hemmer, and this is a Rex sewing machine. Here is my Juki straight stitch. This is not a walking foot. And you can see, I don't know if you can see it on camera over there, but I have a gazillion different feet for this machine. And what I did is, and I actually got this idea from another woman's workroom. This is a magnetic knife. It's for like a kitchen. So you screw it to the wall and put your knives on it. And it's magnetic, so I use it for my sewing machine feet. So they're all right there in front of me. And of course, I try to organize it so different types are together, but then you use them and you end up putting them back wherever. But it works really great because they do hang on pretty good. And I've got every size cording foot for this machine that you can even imagine.
It's a knife holder, not a knife.
Knife holder, sorry. I knew there was a word missing in that conversation. But so that's my Juki straight stitch, not a walking foot. And then buried behind these cushions is my Juki, it's the DNU241H. I can move, my pillows will probably all come tumbling down. But so this one is a walking foot machine. This was my first Juki walking foot, and it works perfectly fine. I got the second one because this one does tend to pucker Sunbrella fabrics a little bit, and the second Juki walking foot I purchased does not do that as badly. or very often. So this is the DNU 241H, which I think I already said that, so sorry for repeating myself. Then over here I have a marrow machine. I have two of these. This is a three-thread marrow machine, and I don't know what the numbers on these are. Yeah, I'm not sure, but anyway, so this is a three-thread marrow machine, which a marrow machine is the same thing as a serger. It serges the edges of the fabrics just like you see inside garments. This is my go-to Juki, and this is a DNU 1541S. The S, I believe, stands for the servo motor, correct, Bill? So this is a walking foot machine. This one has a little bit better control with the knot puckering of fabrics than the original walking foot that I have, but they both work great. And so I do use this one most often, and it's really quiet. With the servo motor, you don't even know it's on. So we've got it so that when you turn the machine on, I have a magnetic LED light here. So I have it so the light comes on, because otherwise I don't even know this sewing machine's on. And my new roll of cording that I have to hang up. And then over here, this is my four thread marrow machine. So again, another serger, but this one has the four threads. And then my conso, which is over here, is a zigzag straight stitch tacker combo. So I can set it up to tack, or I can set it up to zigzag. I use the zigzag on this when I'm gathering like a bed skirt or something. And then over here I have my Sailrite LS1, which I use, like I said, for umbrella cushions. And when I do workshops that are within a certain radius that I can travel in a vehicle, I take that with me so the students can use that on their projects. Because sometimes we don't have, you know, whoever's hosting the shop, the workshop might not have enough sewing machines, so that way we don't have to have anybody waiting. And that has been a really great machine. I really am happy with that. And like I said, they just came out with that double welt foot, which makes it even better. So what else do you want to, does anybody want to see anything else in the workroom here? Whoops, are any questions about anything in the workroom? Let me see if I can get this to cooperate so I can see your questions. Doesn't look like there's anything new that I've missed, although you never know if it's refreshing or not. I don't think I'm missing anything, but if I am, I'm sorry. We'll get answer it later.
Tracy Windley's here on YouTube.
Well, hello, Tracy from YouTube. So Tracy is one of the ones that Bill keeps pocket dialing, so I'm going to have to keep tabs on that girl. So Kara Gonzalez, hello. When making slip covers, do you ever pin fit at a customer's home to make a pattern and then sew back at your workroom? And yes, Kara, that's exactly how I do it. But I have a tickle, so let me take a drink of water here. So what I do when I do a slip cover is I go to the client's home, I measure the piece of furniture and get the measurements for my actual cuts, get the deposit, come back, order the fabric, and when the fabric comes in and I'm ready to go back to the client's house, I actually use the measurements that I got from being there previous, cut all my fabric, go to their home with the fabrics all cut to size, pin fit them to the piece of furniture, bring it back to the studio and sew everything together, serge the seams, and then deliver it all fit, all done and ready to go. And I've been doing slip covers probably about the same time I started drape, so like 2005, and only one time have I had to go back and make an adjustment. So it does work, doing it that way and pin fitting them and then bringing them back and sewing. So yeah, so I don't bring the furniture here. The only time I think I've brought the furniture here is if it was a really funky piece that had like a lot of inside curves and stuff going on that I might have brought it here, but generally I pin fit them all in the client's home, which makes it really nice to not have to bring that extra furniture back and forth.
We have a slip cover class coming up too. Did you mention that?
Yeah, and we have that slip cover class, which I mentioned earlier because Julia had asked the question, and we do have a slip cover class coming up here on November 5th and 6th, which is a Saturday Sunday, and you get to work on your own chair. If anybody does want to do a long distance travel and take that class, unfortunately you won't be able to pin fit your own piece, but we do have furniture that we could have you pin fit and make a slip cover for. So have you ever made slip covers, Kara? Okay, so Sophia's asking about prices for upholstery work. prices vary so much from location to location that I always hate to give somebody a price, say, you know, I charge X amount of dollars for this specific piece. And I do also know that people, there are different variations of upholstery. We, with our upholstery shop, we have a very good reputation in town, and we take the pieces down to bare bones and build them back up from there. It's very rare that we don't take it down that far. I think we've probably only two or three times in our whole time in business have not done that because a client has bought a brand new piece and just wanted the fabric changed. But typically we tear them down to bare bones, so you're respringing, you're repadding, because in my opinion, I don't want to do a project for a client and leave the old foam in there per se, or not retie the springs because they look okay now, because that fabric is going to give them 15 to 20 years of life, and what's in there for current padding or springs may not give them the 15 to 20 years of life. So we tear them down to bare bones, so we are expensive for what we do, but we do the whole job. And we don't leave parts, like I said, there from the old upholstery. So with that said, another thing to consider when you're figuring out how much to charge for your upholstery projects, there's a whole process of numbers that you can do. And Bill, can you help me with the name of Kitty Stein's book? Kitty Stein's book. If anybody. Pricing Without Emotion?
I'm not sure.
Okay. Anybody that's out there watching that knows the name of Kitty Stein's book, can you type it in there in case I am not getting it exactly right? There is a book out there, and I believe it's called Pricing Without Emotion. And it walks through telling you how to figure out your overhead costs. So you figure out, you know, how many number of hours you want to do upholstery a week, what your expenses are related to your upholstery business, and that goes from everything from your electricity to your insurance policies, and breaking that down into like days or hours. So you'd break all your expenses down into per week or per number of hours a week you want to work. And then on top of whatever that figure is, you want to add what you want to make personally for a wage per hour. So let's just, for an example, say your overhead expenses break down to $30 an hour for you to physically be in business. And Bill's making faces at me, so it's probably high, but I'm just kind of throwing a number out there to start. So let's say your overhead costs break down to $30 an hour based on the number of hours you want to work and all your expenses. Then you want to make, let's say, $30 an hour. So you would charge $60 an hour for your labor. So it really, you know, there's so many variables. And you really have to break it down that way, because if I say to you, I charge $600 for this chair, you may not be able to get $600 in your area, or you may be able to get a lot more. So you really have to break it down that way rather than asking somebody what they charge for a specific project. The good question to ask another upholsterer is, how long does it take you to do this specific item? I have a wingback chair with a, you know, an eight-way tie spring system. How long would it take you to accomplish that project? So the answer to that question would be 16 to 20 hours. So you really have to look at it more that way rather than a dollar figure.
So it's pricing your work with confidence.
Pricing your work with confidence. Okay.
The pricing your work without emotion may be Michelle Williams' class.
That may have been a class by Michelle Williams. So thank you, Connie. Pricing Your Work with Confidence. So that is a really great book to help you get your business sense of how to price your jobs. Gwen asks, do we have a video on doing an attached pillow back sofa? We don't have one on doing an attached pillow back sofa, Gwen, but there is a, and I know you're in the membership, there is one in there on doing attached pillow back for a chair, and it is the same exact steps. When you're doing an attached pillow back sofa, it's actually usually broken up into three individual parts, done the same way you would do the one piece for the chair, and then those three pieces, or two if it's a love seat, are upholstered to the sofa. So that video will help you do that. It'll answer the questions you need for that. And within the private members only group, you can always ask questions and share pictures too. So Sophia says, yeah, that's the same way she figures out her pricing as well. Lisa says, welcome back from vacation. Did you need sails on your kayaks? We didn't need sails on our kayaks, but I think I needed an extra float of some sort because we were out kayaking, having a great time, and I was using a sea kayak, which is not something I typically use. My kayak's a much shorter kayak. So Bill's laughing over there already. It's a long, skinny kayak, and he's like, well, let's pull up to the shore and get out of the kayaks for a little bit. And I'm like, sure, okay, let's do that. So he goes and he gets out of his kayak, and I'm pulling up, and he's like, do you need help? I'm like, no, go ahead, I'll be fine. So of course, Kim gets out of the kayak. The whole thing rolls over with me with it underneath the kayak. So there I am crawling out from underneath, and I have a bruise on my arm from that little episode. And so he's standing there laughing. And so then we're getting ready to leave and get back in the kayaks. And he's like, do you need help? I'm like, no, I've got this. I'm good. I did the same thing over again. Went to get in the kayak, flipped it all over. So, you know, I guess I did need help. But he's standing there laughing his butt off at me. Yeah, and he decided to, and then he fell down too, so it kind of made me feel better. But so he started nicknaming me the sinker for the rest of our vacation. But we had a great time. Thanks for asking. Praise your work with confidence. We already got that. So Kara is currently working on a love seat and sofa slip covers with Sombrella upholstery fabric. She has the Juki DUN1541S and also loves it. Yeah, it is a great machine. Aisha says, my new straight stitch machine is a baby lock and I love it. I still may invest in a Juki. Yeah, you can't have too many sewing machines, right, ladies? Come on, or men too. I think Charles is still out there. So you definitely can't have too many sewing machines.
That is a DNU.
Did I say it wrong?
Yeah.
DNU. Sorry, Bill says I said that wrong. DNU1541S. Kara has. But yeah, so my new nickname around the shop is Sinker because of falling out of my boat. Or rolling my boat over. I didn't really fall out. I just kind of rolled the whole thing over with me in it. Any questions that I'm missing from YouTube? Mm-hmm. Any questions from YouTube?
No.
No? Tracy, who's watching from YouTube, is in Arkansas, and she is the one who came out here. She had some training with us back in June, and we had a week together doing training, which was fun. So I'm not getting much of my own work today, but I am having a good time with all of you. There's always enough hours of the day, right? Not. Yep, I'm not seeing any other questions. So those of you that are doing slip covers, so Kara and somebody else I think posted about slip covers, do you serge all your slip covers as well, or do you just sew the seams? I know some people actually do like a binding on the slip cover seam, and the main reason I serge the slip covers is most of my clients will be washing their slip covers, and that way I don't have to worry about the fabrics fraying when you do the serging on the edges. So no one's commenting on that yet. Bill has put up the picture of our hands-on slipcover workshop, so now you can't see me. I can dance. No. I can be silly. Ah, he's got me back on just in case. but yeah, so serging, that's one of those things that a lot of people don't do. And like I said, some put the binding on, which to me is like a huge amount of work. I'd rather pay for a serger because it would pay for itself in the time you save versus doing the binding. The other, I can't think of the name of the stitch. There's a stitch on a domestic machine. Help me, people. What's the stitch on the domestic machine that you can use instead of serging? I can't think of it. It's not the zigzag. There's another one. Overcast, I think they call it. Overcast, overlock. No, overlock is a serger. I think it's an overcast stitch. But also the zigzag you can use as well instead of serging. So I can't see if any of you are answering. For some reason, it's not refreshing again. Oh, there we go. Where did you learn to work with springs? I learned when I first took my very first upholstery class. That was one of the things I had to do for the first, the first or second project I picked had the eight-way tie springs. Overcast, thank you, Carol. That's what I thought, but I wasn't sure. Jessica says, do you pre-wash fabrics for slipcovers if you know the customer is going to wash it? No, Jessica, I do not pre-wash their fabrics. I let them do that. If they want their, if I know they're going to launder it, I suggest that they pre-wash the fabrics. Or if they don't want to pre-wash, then I suggest that they dry clean. So I just don't take the responsibility of washing their fabrics. I know a lot of people do. And I know they, like most people, charge per yard. But I do not do that. Just I don't like doing laundry, so why would I want to wash their stuff? Okay, so Lisa's asking, in reference to her ottoman, and for those of you that may have been with us before, Lisa is doing a figure eight ottoman. Is there a way to get a smooth top with an askew shape? I don't know how to go about it or if it is possible. I know what your ottoman looks like, so I know why you're asking this. There should be a way, and I would say because yours, I think if I remember correctly, yours appears that the boxing is sewn to the top piece, kind of like that white vinyl ottoman I was doing here with the alligator print a while ago, so that it's all sewn in one unit and then put on. Lisa says she's pulling one side and it causes pleats, and then you pull the other way and it pops off the piece. So if it's causing pleats, I would say you need to make your boxing, see how I can explain this. So when you're sewing your boxing around your piece, you've got seams in your boxing to connect your boxing pieces, unless you've railroaded it and had one long piece, which you might not want to do. So what I would do, hopefully this will make sense. If it doesn't, we'll talk about this in the private group later too. But so if you've got your boxing where you've got your seams sewing your pieces of boxing together, I would taper them so that they're, because you need them wide at the top to finish your top piece, but then taper them down, almost like putting a dart in a garment. So when you're sewing the two pieces together, you want to make your seam allowance a little bigger as you go down. That way, when you pull it over the frame, it'll be tighter on the frame and it won't have that area that's causing you to have a pleat. So let's see, you pull one side, it causes a pleat, and you pull on the other way and it pops off the piece. So it sounds to me like you're gonna need to put some staples in there, because that's probably why it's popping off, and I'm assuming you're not attaching it. So what I would do is start, so yours had kind of that funky little center, because like I said, I know what yours looks like. For those of you who don't, I'm totally probably losing you now. I would start on your two thickest ends of your ottoman and get a few staples on one end, and then go to the opposite and get a few staples and do the temporary staple method that I show you on the classes where I have the gun at an angle, and get those held, and then go to your centers where you get the narrowest part, get a few staples there, and then on both sides. Front and back, and then you're going to want to go work in between those areas. So you're going to go, you know, centers at both ends, centers on the side, then centers within those two sections, and then work out towards the areas where your seams are joined in your boxing, because if you have to, at the very end, you could open that seam and rehand stitch it a little bit shorter. But I think tapering your seams will take care of part of that. So I hope that makes sense.
Linda Winston.
Hi, Linda. Welcome.
Where was she? What's that?
Yeah, Bill saw a picture of you with a bunch of lovely ladies earlier today. Where were you guys? It looked like you were having fun. So Lisa, let me know if that helped at all, hopefully. Jane So says, what do you use the 3-thread versus the 4-thread serge for? Heavier fabrics versus stretch? Also, do you have a source for where to purchase threads? Source for where to purchase threads. There's Wawak, which a catalog just came in and it's in the other end of the building. That's W-A-W-A-K. They have threads, and Rolly Company also has threads for your serger. I'm guessing Sailrite might have the lighter weight threads, but I'm not 100% sure on that. But Wawak and Rolly Company both have a great source of threads. And I've gotten most of my threads, I believe, have come from Rolly Company. But I do buy from both of them. So here's the Wawak machine. And they actually are having a sale on threads right now. So it's W-A-W-A-K. And I believe that's their website. So it's wwak.com. But they have all kinds of threads. And they even have like color charts for some of their threads, so you can get a color chart. I used to order so that I had every color for every project that I ever needed. So, you know, when I worked on yellow, I got yellow. And I've gotten to the point now, because I've got so many funky colors that I haven't used for years, and then I go to use them and I find they just start causing problems in the machine because they're too old and dry rotted. So I've stopped doing that, and I have my light threads, my medium threads, and my dark threads, and, you know, in most cases they're good to go. And once in a while I'll order a random spool of something that I just can't get to work with the other threads, but I've stopped having a gazillion threads. Linda said she was out drinking. So back to the rest of Jane's questions. You distracted me there, Linda, with your glass of wine showing up. So the three thread versus the four thread. I really have no reason to use one over the other. The story behind that is there was a company locally, which I wish all of you lived near me when this happened because you would have been in heaven with me. There was a company that used to have a sewing department and they were going out of business. And I got one of the Merrill machines for $100 and the other one for free. So that's why I have one of each, because I figured, what the heck, I got this option, I might as well take them. And they had all kinds of straight stitch machines. They didn't have walking foot machines, but they had everything else. So I really, I go back and forth between the two of them. Let's see, Tracy joined us here on Facebook. Hello, Tracy. Finally got it to play on Facebook. Had to go to Chrome. Hey, so Facebook didn't want to play without Chrome. So Lisa says she normally staples top on, then welt, then boxing. I should trace top and make it to slipcover. So, okay, Lisa, I'm trying to walk through in my head what your frame looks like. So you say you normally staple the top on, then the welt, then the boxing. Should you trace the top and make it more like a slipcover type? Not necessarily. I was under the assumption in my head that, looking at the picture of your ottoman, that you didn't have wood at the top there. If you've got wood at the top there, go ahead and work with it, because I would think it would be easier. So when you're stapling your top on, are you able to get it smooth at that point? So you've got your figure eight top and you're stapling it right to the edge of a wooden frame, if I'm understanding this. And then staple your welt and then your boxing. So while I'm waiting for you to answer that part, you completely followed me. Okay. So if you're doing it that way and you've got the wooden frame, go ahead and go with that, but then still taper your boxing to get it to fit. Tracy actually had a situation a while back with an ottoman where she was having that same problem that you're talking about, where you got a little bit of excess boxing, and that was what we came up with for hers too. So I think that's it. So I am not seeing any other questions. So Linda, I hope you're not out drinking right now. I hope it was just then. I'm thinking, you know, it's only 1:30 in the afternoon, girl. Get back to your workroom. Linda does wedding dresses, prom dresses, all kinds of stuff, alterations. So she's got a really varied day. So I've got, the question just came in, sorry. So Tracy Windley is saying that she would love to hear different ideas for the huge roll of Dacron in storage. You can't see mine right now, but mine is actually underneath the table. So the same, like we have the, what are they called? Conduits, thank you. We get the conduit bars that we have for the rolling rack that you saw earlier. We have one underneath the table hooked to another bracket system. And right now underneath my table is a mess because I got a bunch of stuff stashed under there, which I know we all do that. So Bill's going to move the camera so you can see it. So here is my big roll of Dacron on a conduit pipe. And I put these little plastic, what are they called, crutch tips, Bill? Just so that I don't scratch my legs on the end of the pipes walking by. So my Dacron is under the table. I've heard some people actually hang theirs above the table, which I can't understand how that would work with the way I get my Dacron, because it gets to a certain point where all of a sudden that roll just lets go and the whole thing's on your table or on your floor or whatever. So I don't know how people can hang them up over, but has anybody else got any ways that they store theirs? We've tried like standing it in the corner, you know, and just having it there, but then you gotta lug it up on your table. This works really well. You got a comment, Bill? Oh, I thought you were gonna say something.
Lewis is working on tab tops today.
Tab tops? I haven't done tab tops in a long time. Tracy says she's thinking of blowing out the wall into her husband's side of the shop and putting the Dacron over there. Bill says, bad idea, Tracy. I think Jonathan would agree with that, too. So do any the rest of you get Dacron that way? So my Dacron is 54 inches wide, and I forget how many yards now that I'm saying this. I don't remember, 27 yards, maybe? So it's a big roll. When you take it, when it comes, it's in a shrunk wrap package, so it's probably only, I don't know, 30 inches across, but once you take that shrink wrap off, it just blows up and it's about 5 feet across. So that's, it's under the table. It works great for me that way. I do keep the plastic bag that it comes in underneath it, because with the carpet, the Dacron wants to hook on the carpet. So with the plastic underneath it, until it's, I've used enough that it's off the floor, that just helps it move smoothly. So let's see. Linda says that her Dacron is on the floor like mine. It's like an unruly two-year-old. Yes, it is. It's definitely like an unruly two-year-old. Whoops. So any other ideas out there from the rest of you on storage for Dacron? I know some people probably don't have as big a roll of Dacron, but I find the 54-inch works better for the upholstery, and it's great because most cushions I can do, like the 54-inch width will give me the top, bottom, and front, because I typically don't put Dacron on the back of my foam for my cushions. So nobody else has any ideas for Tracy? Yeah, so we are, time goes by really fast. I swear, the older I get, the faster it goes, which I don't think is such a good thing. So we are at the top of the hour. We have been yakking here for an hour. I haven't cut any fabric yet, but I sure have had a good time. And I hope you will check us out as always, and you know, follow us on Facebook and keep an eye, subscribe to the Facebook Live so that you know whenever we're live. We will try to go live every Wednesday at 12:30. We didn't last week because we were on vacation. We were going to try it from the kayak, but we didn't have good internet there. So we will be here again next Wednesday live at 12:30. I encourage you to go ahead and check out our blog post on our website, which is kimsupholstery.com, and check out our online membership classes at classes.kimsupholstery.com. And I know a lot of you went in there last week and signed up for the free portion of the membership so you could build your own workhorses. And it's great to see all the people come in and sending me emails that they were building their workhorses. So if some of you out there watching need workhorses, you can go ahead and do that if you missed that little one last week. And if any of you are interested in joining us, hi Gina, you're joining us here at the very end. We're almost signing off. But if any of you are interested in signing up for any of the workshops we have, or if you're interested in hosting a workshop in your location, go ahead and shoot me an email. I'm working right now with someone from Georgia. I've got one in Florida we're working on, and someone had reached out in Arizona that we're thinking of doing that one as well. And then we've got the two coming up here this year, and we will have several more coming up here in our location next year. We're currently working on a date for the Ottoman, but with the holidays coming up quick, it makes it tough. And I also will be teaching, for those of you that have followed the Custom Workroom Conference. I taught there last year at 2016, and I will be teaching at the Custom Workroom Conference for 2017. I'll be repeating my headboard class for people who didn't get to attend that class last year, and also doing a class on a chair upholstery project. So I hope that you will join us there. And Tracy Winley, who's here in the feed, is also going to be teaching at the Custom Workroom Conference as well. So for those of you that want to check that out, it's customworkroomconference.com. They don't have registration open yet. I'm not quite sure. I think Susan said sometime in September that would be open. And it is in Nashville, Tennessee, May 1st, 2nd, and 3rd of 2017. So you can check that out as well. We hope to see some of you at some of the educational events we have coming up, or the conference, or back here on next Wednesday at 12:30. So, and also, if you want to learn slip covers, I do have a class on Craftsy. For those of you that don't know Craftsy, that is another educational platform where they have zillions of classes, from quilting to garments to cooking, painting, knitting, crocheting, and slip covers. So you can check me out there. And we do have an option through our website. It's Kim on Craftsy. If you go on the online classes in the drop down, you'll see where you can get 50% off that class as well. So check them all out, and we will see you back here next Wednesday. So have a great rest of your week and an awesome weekend. And I'll talk to you guys on Wednesday. Thanks.